I'm Joel Towers. I'm Dean of Parsons, and it is a great pleasure to give you the president of the new school, David Van Zandt.
Hey, everybody.
Thank you, Joel. Well, applause to all of you. It's really great to see all of you here. You're an amazing group of people, and we're just pleased you're here. And actually, Joel, my job and the job of the faculty and everyone else is to be sure that your school, Parsons, is and continues to be, I think, the best design school in the world. Mm-hmm. It's also our job to be sure that our graduates continue to be successful and have impact. The Parsons education is always going to represent the leading edge of design innovation and socially engaged design practice. Today, we're trying to do that through a number of new programs: our transdisciplinary design program, our MFA in fashion design and society, and our strategic design and management. Both BS and MS degrees are new in the last couple of years and really making good tracks. Finally, this year, the first year, we introduced a new curriculum in the first year. It's going quite well right now. The students love it, as we need to do. We need to keep on the edge. We need to keep changing to keep up with what's happening out there in the world. We also have new and better facilities. We right across the street, I hope you've noticed, there's this big building going up. We're calling it the University Center. And it's really going to be at the heart of our new campus layout here. And it's dedicated, it's full of dedicated spaces, no offices, dedicated spaces for students, you know, performance space, studio space, classroom space. They're going to allow the students from all over the new school to mix and to understand what it means to be interdisciplinary and to work on teams and collaborate. We have a much stronger career services office, which is going to be is connected with the changing career landscape that our students go out and face. We have a number of external partnerships. We also have new global centers now in Paris, in Shanghai, in Mumbai, as well as a wide range of partnerships with New York-based nonprofits and retail enterprises. I think it's fair to say that design in Parsons is really at the center of the new school's overall vision. Not only is Parsons the largest part of the campus by size, and not only is it an important part of our history and legacy, but I think it's powerfully central to the future vision of the new school. And this is really an exciting time for the new school and Parsons overall. As I mentioned, that University Center opens up in January. We actually have 600 students living in the dormitory in the top tower right now, and they say it's great. But the University Center is not just an amazing new building. It's a symbol of the opening of really a new era for the new school, a new vision. And that vision is based on the fact that creativity and innovation are increasingly important to the global economy, to society, what many people call the creative economy. Design, broadly conceived, is really at the leading edge of that change. I like to define design very broadly. It's how we organize objects, environments, and people to make the world a better place. It's about human interface. It's an iterative approach we call design thinking. And the new school is uniquely placed in this world to lead this new world. We're the only university in the world in which a comprehensive world-class design school sits at the heart of a strong social science, humanities, and performing arts programs. This really gives us, the new school, an unparalleled opportunity to be the world's leader in design and social education. Our vision for the new school is that we will lead the education world in the intersection of this broad conception of design and social sciences. The new school will be where design and social research drive approaches to studying the issues of our time. It'll be the intellectual and creative center for effective engagement in the world that increasingly demands better designed objects, communication systems, and organizations to meet human and social needs. So design really informs all we do across the entire new school and is very important to the future. Tomorrow's designer in any area must have a broad understanding of human needs, values, and consequences, something the new school is very good at doing. At the same time, modern social problems require good design, thinking, and creativity and innovation. This is seeing social issues through a design lens and seeing design through a social lens. I think these principles are evident by the work of many of our panelists, or all of our panelists, who really embody this vision. Today we have with us, and welcome, some amazing alums of Parsons and the New School. Our alumni are creative, vibrant, and have made lasting design, lasting impacts in design-related industries. And by being here, they are continuing to support Parsons and the New School as a whole, as well as generations of future graduates and future design leaders. Well, now it's my great pleasure to introduce your moderator, Michael Donovan. He's a prime example. He's an alum who's had incredibly generous, been incredibly generous his time, resources, networks, and ideas. He received a certificate in interior design from Parsons. Should I say when that was? Or should
it's too long ago.
Too long ago. Okay.
They rolled up the building.
Since then, he's going on to lead a range of design and ideas-driven businesses. He's the founder and president of Donovan Green, a brand strategy agency, with clients in media, real estate, development, financial services, technology, consumer products, entertainment, and design. And that's a real example of how broad design really is in all those different industries. He's the founder and chairman and CEO of Coto Responsible, a company dedicated to facilitating sustainable behavior in the automotive category. And finally, he's the founder of Roswell Sightings. This is amazing. You should go to your website and check this out. It's an online experience dedicated to space, space travel, science, and entertainment. And the name Roswell, I'll leave that to your imagination as to what's that. Michael has been very generous with his time, with service on many community and nonprofit boards, including the Municipal Arts Society here, the American Institute of Graphic Arts, the Art Directors Club, the National Design Center, the National Endowment for the Arts, and the Society of Environmental Graphic Design. But probably the most important board on which he has served has been the Parsons Board of Governors, where he's served admirably since the year 2000. So we're very pleased to have him here tonight to moderate our panel, and welcome, Michael, all of our panelists.
Thank you. Thank you, David. Welcome, everyone. It's a wonderful day. It's a beautiful day outside. It's so nice to see you in here. Let me tell you a little bit about myself, and then I'm going to ask my gang here to tell their story as well. I'm Michael Donovan. I'm an alum, like everyone here, and perhaps most of you. I went to Parsons, not my first school. I started out as a veterinarian, which uniquely qualifies me to do what I do today. But then I went to Parsons, and graduated from Parsons, and I taught environmental design, color and drawing. I met my wife at Parsons. She's my business partner of so many years, I can't tell you. And as David said, I've been on the board for quite a long time. So I'm very happy to be here today and share this podium with these guys, because we do something together. And we share something. We're alumni of Parsons, and we're entrepreneurs. Mm-hmm. And being an entrepreneur is exciting. It's scary. It's risky. And I think we'd all agree it's rewarding. So that's really what we're going to talk about today is our experience at Parsons and how that experience informed and kind of helped us launch helped our trajectory anyway. And we're all in these kind of mid-arc paths. I'm clearly the oldest person here, but I recently started another business. I think I have six businesses I've started, and my original business, Donovan & Green, is going strong. So, but let me tell you my story. So I graduated from Parsons, and I was amazingly lucky. I was there was a design couple that many of you know, Massimo and Leila Vignelli. And if you don't know them, they are, you know, what can I say? The subway map, American Airlines, Bloomingdale's corporate identity, product for Alan Heller, the stacking dishes, and on and on and on and on. They've been knighted by the Italian government, and they've won the National Design Award. And when they decided to start Vignelli Associates, they asked me to join them. So with Vignelli Associates, I was the associate, or associates. so it gave me an opportunity to be involved with some amazing work. And it was unquestionably the best job in the world. You know, we made lunch together. Layla and I took turns cooking at lunch. And after a couple, 3 years, I decided to want to open my own company. I mean, nuts, right? I mean, great job, great people, great work, and I want to go out and start my own company. So that's what I did. And that's what all these guys have done as well. So we've gone on to do a whole bunch of things, retail destinations like American Girl Place, and we had an amazing experience. We designed the Reagan Library. They didn't ask our politics. And to spend 18 months with an American president every 6 weeks, spend 6 hours a day, is an amazing experience. Mm-hmm. You know, you hear some amazing stories, and you really feel like you're part of something, and they never try to sort of design the story. We just were able to do what we wanted to do. And so it's been a good run, and it's still going. So I'm going to ask, I'm going to start with Christiane Lemire, Dwell Studios. Let's hear your story.
I'll tell you my story. So I am a graduate of Parsons. I graduated in 1997 from the fashion program. And we were having a brief discussion upstairs about how powerful some of the internships that you're exposed to at Parsons are. So I had a couple of really great internships. My first one being with Isaac Mizrahi. And then my second internship was at The Gap when it was under the stewardship of Mickey Drexler. So those were two really, at that point, sort of polarized experiences. One, Isaac was quite very high end at that point, and The Gap was very much you know, an American institution. The way they structured the company was really solid, very interesting. And then, you know, I woke up one day and decided I got the opportunity to actually to sort of pivot into the furniture business when a friend of mine's husband bought a furniture company called Portico. He didn't really know what to do with it. He was a venture capital person, and he just said, "I need somebody in design. Don't you know that girl?" And so they said, "Will you come and do furniture?" And I said, "Sure." And I think that also goes back to sort of what you learn at Parsons from the foundation, you know, year throughout, is that design is design, and great design is great design, and you can you know, if you have that passion, you can translate to everything from food to furniture to you know, to media to technology to all of these different things. So I went and I started working at a furniture company, and the great thing was it was very entrepreneurial. There was nobody there essentially. And so they asked me to get involved in everything from surface textile designs, which was the original thing I was sort of brought on to do, to furniture design, to sourcing, to international manufacturing. You know, they'd throw me on a plane and send me to China. Back when, you know, that was sort of a new idea in that kind of, you know, higher end boutique business. And I was there for about a year and a half, and I tried some of my designs on the floor, and they resonated with customers. So I thought to myself, I'm just going to do this myself. Although I had no idea what I was doing. Like, somebody said, "We need a PO." And I said, "Well, what's a PO?" So I literally.
A lot of people don't know what a PO is.
Exactly. No, everyone knows what a PO is now. But I had
at the beginning.
Exactly, I didn't know. But I had no idea. And so I had saved up some money. I had saved up, you know, $15,000. I started a business. But at the same time, because I understood design, and now I understood international sourcing and shipping and all these very valuable things, I started doing private label design for a lot of the really large companies, Room & Board, Crate & Barrel, Walmart, Target. And so that was sort of the venture capital arm that fueled the growth of the brand business. Because again, I didn't know what a PO was, and I certainly didn't know what venture capital was, and I certainly didn't know that people would, you know, give you money to start a business. So I figured out how to do it myself. And you know, we had a lot of interesting sort of you know, benchmarks. That was the founding of the company in 2000. Then we launched a baby and kids collection in 2004 that was very successful. And then I went on to do a partnership with Target in 08 through 2011, which was really seminal to the business. We're still in Target in a private label manner. And then I launched a furniture line in 2010, and they actually sold my company, actually merged with a large technology company out of Boston this August. And I think we're going to go on to do some pretty interesting things together in the home space. And we're looking at an IPO in the very near future, so it's really exciting. So, and I think I owe a lot of that to you know, my foundation from Parsons.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have to tell you a little anecdote here. At one point, Nancy and I were working away, and somebody came to meet us, and they said, you know, we really love what you do. We're about to do an IPO, and when, and as soon as we get this done, we want to come back and talk to you about maybe buying your company. And we said, all right. And the guy walks out of the room, and Nancy says, what's an IPO?
So, just a
PF of an IPO. So, Bradford Shellhammer, fab.
Is this on?
What's your story?
Well, this is a trick question, because I want to start in Baltimore, because that's where I'm born. So, you know, I was born in Baltimore, and I think I didn't design my life to be an entrepreneur. I think it was serendipitous. And so I designed the way I live my life, and that turned that into a business, because someone saw something in the way I lived and the way I saw the world. I grew up in a place where you didn't talk about design, you didn't talk about art. I went to a 900-person public school, grew up very poor, but obsessed with music, obsessed with album covers, obsessed with clothing at a very early age. And I never knew that design or creative world could be an option. I knew I had to get out of where I was, and where that meant going to a four-year college. So I did that, and I graduated in 1998, with a bachelor's degree from Goucher College in Baltimore. And I moved to New York City with like $400 in my pocket. And I've done a lot of different things. I've worked retail shops for many, many years. I was a publicist. I sold radio advertising for Clear Channel and Viacom. And there was a point in my life, I moved to San Francisco, and I had started to like develop. I became an adult. I was growing up. And I said, there's more to life than just slogging away and not loving what you do. And so I had the luxury of going back to school at Parsons. So I went to, and my dream was, I wanted to be a fashion designer because I was obsessed with clothing. I've always been obsessed with clothing. And I was telling the story upstairs that I came to Parsons to study fashion design and then realized how much I hated it. And I mean that in the best way, because I think it speaks volumes about Parsons, actually. It's more than just the technical skills that I gained here. And you can take the technical, am I too loud? Oh, okay, sorry. You can take the technical skills, that was a bad one, sorry. No, I just have a pitchy high voice. now I lost, you totally interrupted me and I lost train of thought. But I came here and I wanted to have a store, and I wanted to have a store where you had found objects and things and furniture and fashion, and I was going to make the clothing, and I had it in my head, and I even had a name for it. It wasn't fab. And now looking back on it, you know, that is the business I have. It's just, it's online, and I'm not sitting behind a sewing machine. But, you know, what I was exposed to here was, I gained confidence in my creative skills, which I always thought I had but never had honed in on. And I was also exposed to various design disciplines. And so even though I was in a very accelerated two-year program here at Parsons, I still had the luxury of taking classes outside of the fashion discipline. And it was the graphic design in particular that really was the most inspirational part of it for me, that led me into interiors and is where I am today. I think it's really just my business is a collection of my life, and it's told in a way of just trying to get a lot of people to buy a lot of stuff.
Thank you. So let me introduce Amy Kastenberg. She's our newest graduate, right? Alum.
Yes.
Yeah.
So. I graduated from Parsons in May 2010 from the Integrated Design Program. Prior to that, though, I'm obviously an Aussie and Australian bred, but New York seasoned. I studied industrial design in Australia prior to applying and luckily getting accepted into Parsons. And I came here, I was supposed to be here as an international student for 4 months on a study abroad. And after that 4 months here, I just could not leave, and I went into full force of trying to figure out everything I could do to stay. And luckily I was accepted and to stay at Parsons and transferred in full speed. And it's really, you know, it's been a phenomenal experience from everything. You know, I didn't know how long I'd be able to stay in the US. So for me, I really felt the need to maximize every single day at Parsons. If I didn't have a class, I was at an internship. If I didn't have an internship, I was an apprentice in a factory or whatever it was. I wanted to really get as much as I could out of being a member of the school. And the Parsons name itself has really held so much for me because being able to, the doors that have opened for me purely because I said, you know, well, what school are you at? I was like, oh, well, I'm at Parsons. Oh, okay, come in at 5. You know, and I was like, yes. So, you know, the power of the name of the school and the power of the school itself, and, you know, it's really remarkable. It's something that's known internationally amongst everyone in the world that I come across. So it's definitely an absolute honor to have gone to the school and now be associated with building the school and advancing further in so many new ways. My grandmother was actually a seamstress and my father was an importer, so I grew up between Australia and Hong Kong anyway, so the whole Asia experience, which I feel is very important in the fashion industry to have a lot of awareness of on many different levels, wasn't too new to me, but definitely something that I've become stronger and stronger in as I've grown as a designer. I specialized in accessory design within the integrated design program, and that then when, you know, while I was in Parsons, some my actual first internship was also at Isaac Mizrahi in couture shoes, which is so funny. But and I also interned for Alexander McQueen, and who I initially wanted to go on to work for, and unfortunately he passed away right before I was graduating and was gonna go do that. So I then decided to take another opportunity that had come my way at that time, which was to work for a company named Lian Feng. For those of you who don't know Lian Feng, it's a large wholesale business module. So it's pretty much licensed brands that come in and we design the product. We would design the product for the brand name. And then sell to buyers, retailers, everyone. So the reason I selected that company was quite strategic, and it was because I had, you know, interned for some of the best in the business in high-end fashion. I also apprenticed at a couture house for 3 years, learning really hands-on about making couture accessories. And the couture house that I worked for at the time was housing everyone from, you know, Marc Jacobs, Ralph Lauren, Oscar de la Renta, literally everyone in the fashion business would come and they bring their runway collections, and we would hands-on make the hardware and put together just the pieces for runway. So that was phenomenal as well, which helped kind of build my world of what I wanted to do. So where was I at? Yeah, so I go on a tangent sometimes, but so it was really kind of all these little factors that led me to take the position at Lian Feng, because it would give me the biggest experience in regards to the areas that I was lacking, and the areas I felt that I was lacking was really the fashion business, and understand, you know, I understood how to build a beautiful Python bag and make it myself that would be $1,200 in store or probably more like 4,000. But, you know, I didn't know how to build a bag that would be, you know, beautiful and wearable and saleable and be able to sit on the floor in Macy's or Nordstrom or Lord & Taylor, like at an affordable price point. So that was something that I felt I really needed to understand and to kind of better my overall strength as a designer. So I worked with Lian Feng for a little while, and I really got that there because they produced not just handbags, everything, but I was in the handbag and accessory sector, and I really learned to design to a $500 price point for Bloomingdale's or, you know, a $98 price point in PVC for Macy's or TJ Maxx or whatever it was. So, you know, that opportunity that came to me through Parsons really allowed me to become, I feel, the best designer I could be. From there, I went on to help Vince Camuto launch their new, they had taken handbags in-house, and I helped them relaunch it. And then I was at a point where I had met so many people along the way, you know, I think networking and just building relationships across your journey is so important, because you never know when those people will come back into your life or where you could be later down the track and think, wow, you know, I could partner with that person, or this person would be a great asset to what I want to do in the next stage of my life that I didn't realize I wanted. So I was at Vince Camuto and I decided, you know what, I love contemporary design, I love handbags, but this just doesn't feel right. It's still too corporate for me. It wasn't right for me. So I was thinking, I want to launch my own brand. How can I do it? So I had actually reached out to two men in particular that I thought were fantastic and, you know, I just respected so much in the industry that I had met at my previous companies. And I kind of presented them with the idea. They really specialized in both the financial sector and the business sector of the handbag business. And I approached them with the idea. I designed my first collection on the floor in my tiny little apartment, sketching away to present to them. And I showed it to them. I was like, what do you think? Like, come on board with me. Let's launch Amy Kestenberg. And luckily, they liked the idea. So the three of us combined forces, and we then presented. You know, they put together a business plan with me, and we presented that to various financial investors, both big and small, from multi-billion dollar Chinese companies to, you know, little guys around, in the area, but kind of every different level. And, you know, sometimes I think that, you know, it is important. Hard work is always important. But sometimes there is just a little bit of luck. And I think that we're very lucky and fortunate to have had met a man named Jay Adani, who is kind of a shoe guru in the fashion world in New York. And he loved the idea and he agreed to partner with us. And this was only 11 months ago. So he partnered with the three of us and we've launched Amy Kestenberg collection in November 2012 for summer season. And we've now been, you know, on the floor for 11 months and it's just been a phenomenal experience. It's grown so rapidly and I feel like I'm constantly behind myself like, okay, what's next? So, you know, it's been really a really fortunate experience, and I feel like it really does have a lot to do with the various opportunities that I was presented with being at this school. And I now have, within the last 11 months, we've now launched, I have one label with QVC, which we're now going worldwide with. And I have my main line, which is Amy Kestenberg, which is now available at Nordstrom, where we're partnering with many e-retailers as well, like ShopUp and various boutiques in 5 countries now and across the US. And I'm working on a higher end line now as well. So it's really been a phenomenal experience and it's continuing to grow, which is really exciting. That's
Thank
it.
You. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Thanks, Amy.
Yeah.
So Daniel, start.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hello. Well, thank you again for having me, and it's really an honor to be part of this panel with these remarkable people. My story is one I never expected to actually have my own company. I really never was thinking. I didn't think it was possible, actually, to be an entrepreneur and have my own company. And much like I think a handful of us, I mean, I grew up in the suburbs, and I just had a great high school art teacher that kept saying Parsons, 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 and somehow it got into my brain and I had to go to Parsons. So I was very lucky to come here and to I told these guys upstairs that I met with Tim Gunn when he was the admissions person here at the time before he was a superstar, an Emmy winner. And I got in and came here, and quite frankly, I just expected to be a graphic designer, somebody who put type and color and everything on a page and made it look pretty. And of course, I learned that, but after I left school, even while I was in school, I really learned the importance of being resourceful. And that's one of the skills that I learned here that really has created the ability for me to have a business and to be someone who can lead a team of creatives. While I was still in school, I was very much about internships. I was very fortunate to work for Milton Glaser as an intern in his studio. And then I had a couple other internships as well. I worked, I think it's Stu Ben, as an intern, working for Chris Hacker when he was there. Chris is now at Herman Miller. Yes. But a great influence. And again, one of those great things about internships is that I'm still in touch with him, and he still is one of those types of people who is just really supportive in what I do. And then after school, I was very fortunate, much like you, Michael, to meet Fabian Baron when he was starting his studio, Baron and Baron, in the very early days. And at the time, working on these just remarkable fashion projects on the other side of fashion, other than, you know, not the creating fashion, but doing advertising and marketing for fashion brands. So we did at the time Michael Kors and Issey Miyake, and designed the Issey Miyake fragrance, you know, the L'Odyssée, and Madonna book, which was, of course, a really remarkable project to work on. So at the time, I was just out of school and working for this really remarkably renowned guy, just himself and myself in a studio with a couple interns from Parsons, actually. And then shortly after that, moved with him to Harper's Bazaar magazine and wound up being in magazines for 6 years, working at Harper's Bazaar, at GQ, at Us magazine. And then getting the opportunity to be the creative director, VP creative director for Ann Taylor. And again, it was really every single place I went, it was a matter of using the skills that I learned here, but having to apply them in different ways. So at Ann Taylor, I overseeing advertising and window graphics and all of these other things. So throughout my career, it just kept building into having to do all of these things, being thrown into situations that I didn't really know what to do, but being able to figure it out. And then after that period of Ann Taylor, working for a handful of other agencies, then I sort of got the idea I should really be doing this for myself. And that was the first place I went wrong. And I founded Stark Design in 2000. And really, the trajectory since we formed the company has really been, as a designer, learning that we can actually take on anything, being able to design stores for CVS as we've done, the drugstore chain, being able to design product and packaging for L'Oreal as we do, or Hanes Celestial, or being able to design apps, and we're doing a lot of websites and apps at the moment. And so being able to sort of seamlessly move through all of these different media, and really being able to apply what I learned here, and this sort of multidisciplinary, cross-disciplinary education was really what has provided that for us. And as I told these guys upstairs, we have interns from Parsons. We very much prefer, in a way, Parsons interns, because I really believe in the future that is the world of design, and sort of playing it forward. And so we actively have it. We have interns from all over the world, but the Parsons interns are, of course, the ones that we really give a little extra love to. Don't tell anyone. but really, it's about being able to work with these folks and see them as they are developing, and being able to sort of push them into areas where they may not be comfortable, and being able to sort of hold a hand and say, it's okay, it's going to be fine. So that's really what I got here, and it's just been great. And again, it's great to be here to be able to talk about it.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniel. Thank you all. So I have a couple of questions for each of you. At Parsons, and we'll start with Christiane. We'll start with you. We'll start down there. At Parsons, who influenced you the most? Was it a person or a class, or was there one thing that you sort of look back and say, "Oh my gosh"?
Oh, I mean, like a lot of these guys. So I'm Canadian. So I was, you know, determined to come to Parsons. This was, you know, the exchange rate was never been that good. I badgered my parents. It's much more expensive than going to college here, even. And so I was determined to get here. And I think to me, The thing that sticks out in my mind the most from my Parsons years is actually the internships that I had. So for me to be able to come from Canada and to be with Isaac Mizrahi, to have Donna Karen be my advisor in my last year at Parsons, like just to the exposure to all these amazing people, to be thrown right into it and to have them accept you fully was amazing to me. And I think probably the thing that shaped me the most from my Parsons experience. Yeah. I mean, all the teachers were amazing and the classes were extraordinary, but I think that the accessibility to 7th Avenue as a fashion student was extraordinary.
Oh, that's great. Thank you. Bradford, I'd ask you the same question. Who or what had a really
it's a who.
Memorable?
And it's funny because I didn't think of, I haven't thought about this person in a very long time. It's a Cynthia Rowley, who I don't even know if she's a graduate or not. Is she? Does anyone know that?
No,
no, she's not. She is. Oh, whatever. Well, well, she, I had a portfolio class, like where we put together our final looks, and a guy who worked for Cynthia Rowley taught the class, and she substitute taught one night, and I was the worst illustrator in the whole class. But she loved my sketches more than anybody else's, and she said, "There's passion in what you're doing with your hand, and you have something to say in this world, and you should say it." And then it led us to, and she won't know who I am if I, maybe she does. So I started telling her about this book I was obsessed with, and it's called Arlene Dahl, and she was this kind of pseudo celebrity in the '60s, and she's most famous for being Lorenzo Lamas's mother. But she wrote Beauty Tips and was a columnist, and she wrote this book in the '60s, which everyone needs to go and run. And I hate telling people about it because then they buy up the copies and then they're all gone again. And I love giving it away as a gift. So it's called Always Ask a Man, Arlene Dahl's Key to Femininity. And in that book, it talks about things like, you know, taupe is the chicest color. You know, never finish your meal in front of a man. And my favorite is she asked all this advice from all these Hollywood stars on what they should do to look like, to attract men. And they're all gay, but they weren't gay then. And so it's the best book ever. So I said, you know, this was such a special experience. I am going to send you this book. And she gave me her address, and I went, because I have like a stack of them. My husband's here. I'm sure we have a couple in our house still. Because I try to give them out to people. And so I wrote it to her and I sent it away and then never heard back. And then like 2 months later, I get a package in the mail. And it was a pair of underwear that had this like graphic tribal pattern on them. And they were in the original packaging and it said 79 cents. And it was from Kmart. It was Kmart private label. And they're the most amazing graphic underwear. And Cynthia Rowley wrote back saying, "That book was so great, I thought you needed this underwear." And so the underwear is in my upstate house framed in a white box on the wall with all these other memorabilia from the things. But what it's so funny because the question just spurred, it was a turning point in my life where I realized that, you know what, someone who's a celebrity, someone who's famous, someone who's known, someone who has a lot of money, someone whatever, they're all people, and if you just talk to them, they'll probably do something with you.
Yeah, yeah, it's true, it's true. So Amy, I'll ask you the same question. Who or what? Was the most memorable experience at Parsons?
I think there's a few for me. I've got to say, prior to, like, just the whole way through, it's really my father, who is an importer in Australia and really kind of exposed me to the world of business and fashion at a very young age. And kind of really pushed me the whole time to every time, you know, you fall, it defines you when you stand back up. And I think there were a lot of times throughout my experience at Parsons where, you know, I was working so hard and I felt like there were days where I just wasn't moving forward. And I would always say to him, like, "I'm working so hard and all these kids are so good. I'm like, how do I stand out? Like, how am I going to get ahead?" And he's always said to me, you know, "It's the kids that have it the hardest that fall and then stand back up and keep going. That's what's going to make you great." And that's always really stuck in my head. And I think that's something that's a really important kind of factor with being at Parsons in general, that it is such a challenging design school. And I feel that it's probably one of the hardest college experiences. And to make it to the end of it and still keep going and still believe in yourself and, you know, not let anything that comes at you that, you know, maybe doesn't understand you or as a designer doesn't understand your vision or what you believe in, being able to have that happen outside of Parsons and then come back internally and have your professors and, you know, your peers be like, they just don't understand you because you're great, you know, because they don't understand your vision or because, you know, they're not able to think at a creative level that you are or that we are or that, you know, that it can't see the future like you can. And it's a gift as a designer to be able to see that level of creativity. And I think it's very important. And that's something I learned amongst my peers and teachers here, to stay true to who you are, stay true to what you believe in, and to not give up on that, and to feel great and strong about who you are and what you believe in and what you want to do with your life, whether it's, I don't know, cooking as an art, you know, as the other guys mentioned. I do believe that Parsons allows you to really strengthen design in any field. And I know that for a fact because I was not trained in many of the fields that I'm now expanding into as a designer. And yeah, I think that it was really the whole experience and the people around me in the school that really helped me to grow. And one person in particular was a lady named Talene Richter, who was one of my mentors, who I met at my first internship at Isaac Mizrahi with Liz Claiborne. And she really took me in, and I would go to her with questions of, you know, I just got an internship with Ralph Lauren. Can I do it? Should I do it? What should I say? And she really took me under her wing and kind of advised me through every major career decision. And it's really, you know, she's very much a special person in my life who's allowed me, I believe, much so to get to where I am today.
Thank you. Thanks, yeah. Thanks, Amy. Daniel, is there one person that had a profound influence on you at Parsons?
Yeah, I mean, I can think of many that that really provide, well, it could be my friend here in the front, but I will never forget a piece of advice or a piece of training that I got from Fred Woodward. One of the reasons I came to Parsons is because I had watched Bewitched growing up and on TV, and I wanted to be Darren. It's true. I wanted to be on Madison Avenue making ads. I thought, you know, that's got to be great. And so I came to New York thinking, well, you know, Parsons, New York, it's, my teacher kept telling me it's the greatest place to go, so I'm going to go to New York and be an ad man. And as I got into school and got these lofty goals, I sort of realized, I don't want to do advertising. That's like selling my soul to the devil. So I'm going to do design. And one of the great things about Parsons is that there are a lot of great teachers here who are in the business of doing whatever it is you want to do. And one of my teachers was Fred Woodward, who's now the creative director at GQ magazine. He had been at Rolling Stone for many years and has just a remarkable portfolio of work and a reputation. And Fred said to me, and I'll pass it on to you now, but it's Fred who gave this word of advice. As a designer, when you're looking for a solution to something, you go through everything you know how to do first. You know, on the screen, you know, we're now working on computers, but you make it bigger, you make it smaller, you make it this, you make it blue, you make it black, you do all of those things you know how to do. And once you get through to the end of that, that's when you start designing. And that piece of advice really sticks with me to this day. And I really do use that. So, Fred. Thank you, Fred, wherever you are.
That's great. Thank you. Thanks, Daniel. So, Christiane, do you think there's something at Parsons that prepared you to be an entrepreneur, or was it just something that you needed to do?
Maybe it's a little bit of both. I think when you have the entrepreneurial spirit, you're going to do it. Nothing's going to stop you. And I knew as a young girl that I wanted to do this. I was always trying to come up with some sort of, you know, business. Whether it was, I had so many of them. But I think you know, coming to New York and going through the grueling training at Parsons, you know, 4 years of very difficult school, really learning how to work hard, to negotiate the city, to do all those things. Those are invaluable stepping stones in entrepreneurship. And I think one of the things that, you know, the three ingredients to successful entrepreneurship, one of them is passion. So you have to be very passionate to come here because you're passionate about the discipline that you're in. You also have to be willing to work very hard. And I would challenge anybody to find a school that makes you work harder than Parsons. I mean, it's like 24/7 draping, sketching, running around. And it felt like a very real world situation. So I think you'd have to go off and do that in a job as well. And I think exposure to New York City and exposure to all of these relationships, whether it's, you know, with all of the amazing teachers who are in the industry, or to world-class advisors, like in my case, it was Gloria Sachs and Donna Karen. But you know, people that would tell you without batting an eyelash whether something was good or bad or not, and you have to sort of, you know, take it and internalize it and live with it. And so I think those are pretty profound stepping stones in entrepreneurship. So I think it was really helpful to me to be able to have the courage and, you know, will to work after Parsons to go on and start a business.
Thanks. Bradford, how would you answer that question? I mean, what compelled you to...
It was good answers, though. I agreed with all three. I don't know what the question was.
The question was really, what was it... was it Parsons? Okay. And how Parsons prepared you, or was it just you're nuts and you just wanted to have your own business?
I mean, well, I didn't want to have my own business, but I do think entrepreneurial spirit is something that you're born with. I think it's a fearlessness. I think it's a healthy thing to talk about students with and to teach students with, but I also don't think it should be like what everyone should be forced to do, because I actually think it's not for everyone. And it's oftentimes really uncomfortable, and it can be a lot of other things, like you don't get to design if you're running your business. You actually have to run the business. And sometimes that means, I think someone was talking about taking out the trash. Maybe I made that up. I think that you're born with it. I think it could be honed in on and fed at school. But here's the deal. If you have an entrepreneurial spirit, who the hell cares if you have nothing to back it up with? So what Parsons provides is something to back it up with. So you're either going to, you have to have something. I mean, you have to have a skill set. You have to have a level of intelligence. You have to have something. If you have this dream, you can't. Dream's not enough. And so what Parsons did for me was gave me a confidence that I think lacked before, that allowed me to be an entrepreneur. But I mean, much like you, I always knew I wanted to be the boss and tell people what to do and say, this is me, look at me. It happened to me much later in life than certain people on the panel. Never give up too, I think. I had an experience of being an older student here, which I felt like a fish out of water at times. But it allowed me to feel young again. And to also realize that you can keep on learning. So if you're in a workplace and you're not learning, something's wrong.
Yeah, I agree.
The level of risk that you're willing to take. I think that's one of the things about entrepreneurship that, it's pretty risky and most businesses fail. So if you're not willing to do that, and a lot of people are uncomfortable, it's probably not for you. And I think that's one of those things that's impossible to teach.
Yeah, I was gonna at some point interject that one of the ingredients of entrepreneurial behavior is winning is great and losing isn't, and it's all about risk reward and what's your tolerance,
also known as insanity.
I had a friend that was starting a business, and we used to talk late into the night. And we were trying to help each other. And at one point I said to Dennis, you're going to be successful. And he said, how do you know? And I said, you don't have any choice. And he said, you're right. Yeah. It's like failure is not an option here. Yeah. So, Amy, let me ask you the same question. What was there one around entrepreneurial behavior?
Well, actually, to what you just said, I think a part of being a successful entrepreneur is really having that mentality that failure isn't an option. Because to me, I guess something not working out the way I wanted it to, I don't see that as being failure. I see that as being something that was meant to be that way, something I was supposed to learn from, whether it be in a good learning experience or a bad one, you're still learning. And I really feel that it's very important to have that mentality to, you know, constantly move forward and just be failing isn't an option. And why is this gonna work? Because it has to work. That's a mentality that I've always had, even when certain things haven't worked out the way I'd planned. I just made sure that, you know what, that's okay. What are we gonna do about it? I see everything as a challenge. And I think as long as you move forward in your career and with the challenges that come your way, as picturing it that way in your head, as it's just a challenge and it's a problem that we need to solve. And that's the way I kind of move forward with everything I look at and everything that happens, both in my business and personally. And okay, tell me the question again.
What prepared you to be an entrepreneur?
You sent me on a tangent again. I think, again, to Bradford and Christiane's point, I think they covered it very well. I think there are multiple, you know, kind of things that led me to get to that point. Parsons, I mean, the teachers I had, and again, the grueling process, definitely part of getting me to where I am now. Also, just being able to be a part of the school and use the school name to open doors that generally may have not have been accessible for me. You know, coming from Australia, Melbourne, Australia, you know, the idea that I would, you know, when I was younger, the idea of me working for Ralph Lauren as an intern while studying at Parsons was like, if someone would have told me I'd be where I am now and studying where I studied, I would have been like, you're funny. You know, I would never would have thought that to be possible. So I think Parsons really opens the door to possibilities that may not have been there in any other way or capacity. And little funny story, when I was interning at Ralph Lauren, one of my first tasks was to organize the belt closet. So for the whole day, probably for 14 hours, I literally stood there and rolled every belt and put an elastic band around it and then put it in a particular box based off the color of the belt and the size of the belt. Thought to myself, like, really? Like, is this what I'm gonna be doing for the next 6 months? This is what's gonna be my job? But one thing that I learned early on was, no matter what I do, no matter how mundane the task, it's so important to always do it to the best of your ability and give it 110%. And that closet was the best closet you have ever seen.
That's great.
And I remember my supervisor at the time was Ralph Lauren's niece, and she had come back and she was like, wow, you did a really good job. And I was like, thank you. And she's like, that's a great looking closet. I was like, thank you. And it was that, from that moment, that she wrote me a reference letter that then went on to get me my next job, you know? And she was like, no matter how mundane the task, Amy is willing to do it 110%. I was like, so I always went on to tell that story to anyone I ever interviewed with or met, you know, tried to get an internship with. They're like, what did you do that was so mundane? moral of the story, I would always do your best, because you never know who's watching, what it's for, what could come out of it, and just always present yourself how you know, want to be perceived and for who you are.
Thank you. Thanks, Amy. I want to ask Daniel a different question. Just when he was working on the answer. Well, you can answer that. If you want to do the entrepreneur thing?
Go, go, go. All right, no worries.
All right, so the question I wanted to ask you is, when starting a new business, what do you think is more important? Work skills, really understanding how to write a business plan or, you know, do the books or hire people, fire people. So is it work skills or is it a passion for the work? What's more important?
Well, you're talking to a designer
here. I know
so
I am.
So I think
and a good one.
Thank you. I think that passion is going to be the answer. But that said, passion is what got me to start a business. But what gets us to keep the business going is the skill, right? And I think that all of us probably up here have learned so much about how to run a business, how to operate a business. I don't really spend any time designing anymore. I mean, I do some, but it's really more about the business part of the business that gets me up every morning and kind of gets me jazzed. I never expected that to emerge, having come to Parsons to be a graphic designer. But it's the skills. I mean, I had to learn at a certain point how to do QuickBooks. You know, I had to learn how to do, our accounting. I had to learn how to do all of it so that I could really understand the mechanism of how the business works. And being able to do that, I think, makes me a better everything, a better business owner, a better manager, and actually a better designer, because I really do use that creative process to think through a problem, even if it's a management problem, even if it's an accounting problem. I mean, quite frankly, when I was looking for a new accountant, I interviewed accountants to see how creative they were about dealing with problems. And I never knew before that you could actually have an accountant that was creative.
Well, Bernie Madoff had a great one.
Well, I'm glad he wasn't my accountant.
It's possible. I don't know how long you can go on that basis, but so Amy, let me ask you the same question. What's more important in your opinion, sort of work skills or skill at work, passion for work?
I think it's both equally. I think the most important, I mean, obviously to be a designer and have talent and be very passionate is very important to your point in the beginning. But from that stage forward, I think it's very important to create a strong team. I wouldn't be where I am if it wasn't for my team. And, you know, my team are, you know, I chose them very, you know, very strategically and specifically because they were amazing at what they did. And in my opinion, the best at what they do. And I looked at kind of the areas that I felt I lacked, as I mentioned before. And I think having a great team as an entrepreneur is what's going to allow to take you to the next level, because realistically, as you get busier and as you grow, you can't do everything yourself. As much as a control freak that I am, and I am, that's one thing that I'm still learning to let go of, is the fact that, you know, delegating, being a good, a great delegator and a great team player, to me, is what makes a company stronger and a team stronger and allows you to move forward faster. You got to have your people that you know you can trust and rely on for the areas that you can't do or something you can't be at. So, you know, I partnered with a gentleman named Sean Elan and also Adam Protas, and who, to me, are the best at what they do and have allowed me collectively to us to grow this company to, you know, a $10 to $12 million company in 11 months. So your team is the most important thing to me.
Bradford, I'll ask you the same question. Work skills or passion for the work?
I think the answer is obvious. It's a combination of the two. I mean, I don't think anyone's going to argue with that. But I do think the one thing I would say is the job of being an entrepreneur can be a distraction to the job of being whatever you are. And luckily enough, I've had a business partner who we pretty much have split kind of the brain and the soul of the business in equal parts. But one thing that I've seen as that has actually gotten in the way or caused damage to us along the way is when one of us tries to do something that we're not the best in the world at. And so I think you have to balance the passion with the work, but the work doesn't mean that you have to be great at balancing the books or great at hiring or firing people or great at whatever. I think the greatest lesson I've learned as an entrepreneur is to figure out the one thing that you do better in the world than anyone else and clear every single thing in your way that doesn't let you do that every single day, every single hour, every single minute. And I think a lot of that time means finding people who are smarter than you, who have more skills than you in other parts, people who are passionate about other things that you're not passionate about. Just because you're the founder of a company doesn't mean that you can't hire people who are not passionate. And so, you know, having that gut instinct, and even an accountant, bless their hearts, you know, there might be one or two out there who has passion. Find him or her. There's no one way to do it. We all have different stories. There's a million other entrepreneurs out there that have different stories. And I think the one thing you'll take away from it is that it's a balancing act of all things.
Right. So would you agree, Christian, or do you? Yeah.
No, I mean, I would absolutely agree. I think passion is what starts the business. If you don't have that, it's never going to get off the ground. It's never going to start. So I think you have to start with a passion and figure the rest out along the way.
Well, thank you. So we have about 20 minutes, I think, that we can entertain questions. There's a great group here.
Thank you.
Is there any questions anyone in the audience would like to ask? Any one of these guys?
I'll ask.
Of course you will. Kay Unger.
Can hear me.
Kay is the president of the
chairman governor. Of the board of Parsons.
Chairman of the board of governors of Parsons.
So what I mentioned to them upstairs was that they're so young, and I think we, especially people even younger than I am, we're so learning from you. So you talk about hiring people. That really, and I've learned the same thing, when you're an entrepreneur, you want to do what you do best. So you try and hire the other people who might do those other things better. I'm asking any one of you, I think Bradford might answer it first though, is what do you ask them that is key in that interview that might give you a clue of whether you're getting to the right place? Because I think the interviewing process of all the people we hire, and most of us probably may, some of you may have HR, but still got to come from your gut, is how do you do that and how do you build your team so that you can do what you do best?
I'm really good at interviewing. I interviewed the first 200 employees of our company, and that's all in 1 year. So I'm pretty skilled at it. And I don't stick to the playbook. Like, I go way off, and I usually start asking if they want a drink. I'm not kidding, because the people who don't, that's a check against them. And then I always offer them candy, because I have candy in my office, and the people who don't eat candy, I'm like, oh, they're going to be a tight ass, and they're going to get on my nerves, because I can't have fun. And so, but then the real questions I ask are a combination of any. One is, what did your parents teach you? It's not your typical kind of, a lot of these playbook interview questions are all about trying to see how people solve problems and all of that. And you know what? I don't really care about that. I care about if I would actually be able to sit with you for two hours at dinner and share a bottle of wine. If you can get past that test, we're good. So I ask the thing about what their parents taught them. And then I obviously want to see their passion. So I'm saying, what did you buy on Fab? I didn't buy anything. And I'm like, oh, well, yeah. And then, like, the only people I feel sympathy for is, like, you know, I've been unemployed for 6 months, but I love this thing. I wish I could afford it. Or, you know, I just graduated college. I wish I could afford it. But if you're coming in there at director level or above and you haven't bought anything yet and you haven't experienced the service, you're not getting hired. So you better love what I love and love our company.
That's good. Yeah. Yeah.
For me, it's very much about instinct. I think it's important to have strong instincts for the people that you can work with and the people that you've just gut instinct of who you feel, you know, inspired by, or you feel their passion, and to Bradford's point, I think it's very important for the person, for me to not to hear it, but to feel that the person genuinely wants to be there, because everyone in my team, I don't know about, you know, every company, but everyone in my office genuinely wants to be there. We don't even consider it work. It's our life. We live it, we breathe it. I think part of being an entrepreneur is being 24/7, and that's a lifestyle. is not having a life. So, you know, that's very important, I feel, in being a successful entrepreneur. And I think passion and also a willingness to learn. I'm interviewing right now because we're growing very quickly and I'm hiring a few designers. And one of the questions that for me, I always ask is, you know, tell me what you know about me. Tell me what you know about the brand. You know, I always test to make sure that they know their stuff because I just think it's silly to go to an interview and not know who you're interviewing for or who you're working with. You know, we're very fortunate to have a company atmosphere where it's almost family-like and everyone that's there we pick very strategically because we consider them a part of the family and they're growing this with us together. We don't consider people an employee, even though they are, we don't see it that way. They're a part of our world and our vision and making that vision get bigger and take over the US of A. So, you know, it's very important for us that whoever's there and genuinely lives it, breathes it, wants to be there, but not in speaking, just in feeling. Yeah.
Right. We're streaming this, yes? Do we have questions from? No, okay. All right. Yeah.
Dee Miller, Parsons grad, also on the board with Kay. Daniel and Michael, you are in a different type of business, design business, than the other three. You have a design house and customers. Do you now sell your services, or is your brand so large that you turn people away? And what was the one account that you might have lost that you really wanted?
You or me? Go ahead.
I'll take it.
Good question. Thank you. Yes, we turn work away, of course. Sometimes it's not a right fit, the budgets aren't right, whatever it is. Being in a design services company, as we are with clients and customers, as you say, sometimes there does need to be a fit, or there needs to be an alignment with what we do and with what the brief is. In terms of the other part of your question being the remind me the second half of your question.
The account.
Yeah, the account that got lost that got away. Yeah, right. Well, the one that sticks out for me, we had an opportunity last year with Samsung to conceive and design their sort of store of the future, so to speak. And we're a teeny tiny little player compared to some of the other folks that they were meeting, but they had come from Korea to meet with us, and I thought we had a great meeting. We had some great conversation, but it didn't go that way for us. And so, you know, you win some, you lose some. I mean, that's how an agency works. And it would be nice to win them all, but that's just not how it goes. That would have been a great project. I think we had some great ideas for them, but that's okay. They'll come back.
Let me tell you, we got that job. And it wasn't that great. So we don't really have clients. We have, and this sounds like a cliche, but it's absolutely true. And Nancy and I, years ago, we created a kind of a gating item. So we made ourselves slightly unavailable. If the founder or CEO wasn't willing to spend time with us, a lot of time, and we figure when the President of the United States is willing to spend 18 months with us, you know, that sets a pretty good bar, right? So if they're not willing to engage with us, then we don't want the relationship. And we're not really interested in some kind of middle level, phone it in, you know, because we're CEOs, you know, we're leaders of our company, and we want to relate and partner with somebody that has the same, he or she has the same responsibility. So we've really created a lot of value for our clients. We've re-engaged with American Girl, and we were told the other day that 60 million people have gone through that few stores, you know, That's pretty cool. I wish I owned it. So, so what we started to do is we started owning things. I mean, that's one of the things. It's not just starting Donovan and Green, you know, which is an entrepreneurial activity unto itself, and a lot of people and this and that. And we even sold a Donovan and Green and started another one. But what we realized was what's really fun is when you can take all the skills that we deploy for other people and take those same skills and, you know, we're all doing this into businesses that we that we own, you know? So then the question is, should it be black? I think it should be black. You think it should be black? It should be black. That's it, you know? There's no, yeah, you know, you don't have to like work on the presentation. You take a shower, you know, and it's gonna be black. So it's a very smooth process. But anyway, that's how we've chosen to work, and it's worked out pretty well.
Yeah, I'm gonna add to that. Can I add to that?
Yeah.
I'm gonna add to that. Because you bring up a good point. And it's true, working for clients sometimes maybe isn't the right fit or isn't as, maybe as rewarding as doing your own thing. So we also I have a line of books that's coming out starting next month called Paper Pups. Look for it in the stores, thank you. And again, creating our own products is something that we've been up to lately and are also working on. So I'll be talking with these guys to pick their brains more. But it, quite frankly, it, that's the whole thing. There's no committee. There's no anything. You have a vision and you can do it. So half of my time is spent really developing that side of the business, and the other half of my time is really spent with clients.
There's a question there.
Sarah from Livestream would like to know, Amy, how did you go about approaching retailers to pick up your line?
This is a good question. I actually, once I had partnered with our financial investor, we were able to afford to put together a showroom, and I immediately flew to Asia, built the collection that I had designed on the floor in my apartment, brought it back in, and then we literally reached out to them ourselves. My team members, some of them had relationships with some of the retailers, the department stores, and buyers, and they had reached out to them, and obviously they didn't respond right away, but we kept pushing. We didn't stop. I think they all got sick of us, actually. I think they probably saw our names on their voicemails so many times that they were like, you know what, let us just Google them. And they probably looked us up and saw that, you know, we had a little, you know, luckily they probably saw that I went to Parsons and had won a couple of designer awards, so that definitely helped us get their attention, which again wouldn't have happened if I wasn't at this school. Yeah, I think it's just really persistency. You know, we worked really hard to get them there, and when they came in, you know, I was selling for my life, you know? So we worked and we were really passionate. And I think the difference between my brand and probably a lot of others is I didn't have to lose. It was like this, it was like do or die for me. And, you know, I was passionate. I wasn't an open book. They came in, I presented the collection to them. I was like, this is what I have. This is what I believe you're missing. And I think that also, you know, I really looked for white space in the industry before building my line. I was very conscious of, you know, I went into every single retailer that I wanted to be in. I went into their stores. I shopped their floor. I felt that they were missing my product, like a contemporary all-leather brand at the right price that, you know, would really resonate with their customers. So I knew my stuff. So when they came into the showroom after, like, a long time of harassing them, and walked the line, the collection, but, you know, they were like, oh, this is great, but, you know, we're not sure if we need another brand, because it's very challenging at this point, you know, this time of what's going on in the world to launch as a new designer and a new brand, and how many handbag brands are there, you know? You really have to have something good for them to really take a chance on you. And I felt that they did to my core, and I made that very clear to them. And, you know, they came back and worked with me for the first two seasons. The second season, they picked us up. First season, they gave me a lot of feedback of, you know, what they felt they needed me to change slightly. And I did that, and I just kept going forward. I think also, you know, we were very fortunate. I think, you know, again, sometimes you're just lucky. We had QVC come in our first season. They loved the collection. They picked us up in a big way. And that also very much helped put us on the map very quickly, because there's nothing like being, there's no marketing or, no offense, or advertising campaign that can put you in front of 200 million people every day. Every time I'm on air on QVC, you know, it's 150 to 200 million people that are just seeing me present my bags. And, you know, I think we were very fortunate to have had them pick us up, and also to be working with players such as Nordstrom, who believe in us now and have helped me to get there. And I, again, tying back to Parsons, I think that was very heavily because they knew I was a Parsons alumni and they wanted to help me, and they believed in what I was doing and that I had the right product at the right price and saw that we could deliver. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Amanda Curtis, and I just launched my company, 19thAmendment.co, exactly 2 weeks ago.
Congratulations.
Thank you. It's been a full year of just building this and just prepping our business plan, et cetera. And what we are is we're a Kickstarter for emerging fashion designers, and then we manufacture for them in the U.S. on their behalf. So really giving them the tools to bootstrap a fashion label. Right now, it's so much sink or swim. And my question is, what do you know now that you wish you knew in those very, very early days?
To me?
Anyone.
Oh. I don't know, that's a tough one.
What do you know, Christian?
I mean, it takes a lot of money to make money, is one of the things I had no idea very early on. I had no idea how much money it actually takes to get a business off the ground and make it sustainable and make it grow. In some ways I wish I'd known that and been prepared for that early on.
Mm-hmm. I think that don't be married to your vision of what you think your company is right now, because it's going to change, and it's going to change in a lot of ways. And in my case, it changed to a completely different business model with a different name. Every time you have to shed part of what you dreamt originally, it hurts a little bit, but not resisting that is what I would, at the same time, maintaining integrity, and it's, I know it doesn't make sense, but you have to hold on to some things but let go of other things. And had I known to do that without losing sleep over it, that would have been a good thing.
That's very good advice. Yeah.
I would say that I think it's important, I'm not so much to answer your exact question, but just on a side note, I think it's really important to know that there's a need for what you're offering. I think Made in the USA is definitely, you know, very wanted right now. But at the same time, I would question internally, what do you actually want out of this? Made in the USA generally is harder to be highly profitable, and I guess harder because you can never, it's hard to expand the amount of product that you're making when it's all made by hand in the USA. I think it's admirable, and I think it's great if you can do it, but I definitely think it's probably riskier in a way. Then,
but honestly, manufacturing's been coming back, we're making a lot of things in the U.S. I think maybe the handbag world is, I don't have as much, but there are lots of things, especially I think with textiles, where you can do a lot of stuff in the U.S. at competitive prices, and honestly with much lower minimums. So you can either buy a lot of shit that's cheap and have too much, excuse my language, have a ton of it, or you can buy less that's more expensive without the inventory risk. So, you know, there is.
And also the fashion manufacturing sector is so developed here, especially for clothing, that it's not.
I guess to my point then, I would just
sorry.
No, listen, no, sorry. Now I almost swore. Now.
Give her some support, for God's sake.
I feel like now I'm like anti-American. No.
Get out.
First of all, my company actually, the Adani Group, have a factory in the USA, in our office, where we produce made in America footwear and handbags. It's called 397. It's something my partner is working on very tirelessly to bring 3% of all design and development back to the USA. Thank you very much. So, but in saying that, I guess my point was just to make sure that whatever it is that you're designing or producing is needed in the marketplace, like target where you're looking to sell them to, and make sure it's just not a replication of something that's already there. Like, I feel it's important to have a reason to exist, is what I'm saying.
Hi, my name is Phoenix Lindsay Hall, and I have a question. I just graduated this May with my master's here from Parsons. So I'm curious.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So I'm curious what advice you have for a newbie that still doesn't have a job yet and that still is thinking about starting something but not sure. Or
what was your major?
Photography. I'm an artist.
Awesome. Well, use that name.
Exactly.
I mean, you were born with a brand, and so whatever you do, use that name.
Thanks, Mom and Dad.
No, just do it. Just do it. I think that if you're willing to take the risk, because if you don't, you'll always be wishing you did.
And I think you should talk to Daniel.
Well, no,
it's hiring.
No, I was just going to say, you know, we spoke earlier about failure, and actually I think failure is like a concept. I don't think it's an actual thing, you know. I don't think there's a failure, you know. Yeah. If you really have a passion.
Well, our government.
Well, there's a good example.
Okay, Bradford.
There's a good example.
Yeah, exactly. No. I made a point. No politics, no religion, no sex. So.
Exactly.
So I'm just going to leave that one. But you're right. In business, in being your own, I just don't think there's failure. You know, if you have a passion to do something, you want to do something, just do it and see where it goes. And you're absolutely right. It's going to lead to something that's valuable, learning experience or whatever it is. So you can't really lose, you know? I would say if you want to start your thing, start it. See what happens. And you never know what it leads to. You never know the people that you're going to meet. You never know really what you're going to get out of it. If you get the business of your dreams out of it, great. And if you get something else, great. And most likely, you'll be surprised.
And there's a reason why the five of us are sitting up here. It's because we have a need to feel connected back to something. And so what I would suggest is you find someone that you respect and admire their work, who have achieved something that you would love to do something in your world, and email that person, call that person, or befriend that person, and find a mentor and someone who can coach you and help you. Because we have a very and it could come unexpected, but it may rock that person's world you may give them something back. But I would say find somebody who you admire, who has done something or is doing something, and strike up some kind of connection with them to help you, guide you, because mentorship is a very important thing.
Yeah. I would also say, just lastly, is I do believe it's important. I mean, I reward anyone that wants to go out and do their own thing, because that's, you know, very risky and you have to have a lot of balls to do it. But I also know from my personal experience that I learned so much working for the companies I worked for prior to doing my own thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, I would have lost a lot of money if I had done it on my own, which I initially was going to, and then decided to work for some other companies that I felt I could learn from. I think it's important to learn on other people's money, is what I'm saying.
I wish I would have had that advice a couple of times.
Don't quote me on that. But
I could have used that advice a few years ago.
I think it'd be good for you, to Bradford's point, to find who the photographers are, or, you know, that really inspire you, that
you would ultimately love to learn from and target working for them as your next big step or your next goal to really see, you know, maybe it's not what you want, but how do you know until you experience the industry? Because I think being a student in any field and actually working in the industry in that field is two totally different things. So, I would just say.
You do it all at the same time.
Yeah, that's true.
We have.
All the same time.
we have one question from our audience.
Adrienne from Livestream would like to ask about investors. She says that many designers don't know how to look for capital and partners. How did you do it?
Is that me?
I didn't.
Is it?
I didn't until recently. So I bootstrapped it in the beginning. So.
I mean, I partnered with, as I mentioned, my teammates, and we put together a business plan, and we contacted, I think we were fortunate enough to have already had many connections in the industry that we had purely came off relationships based on, you know, people we'd met in New York, and, you know, I talked to everyone. So we really, I think just being in good at networking and building relationships with people in everything you do and everywhere you go is just really crucial to being able to turn back and be like, well, who do I meet that, you know, may be the right person to present this to, who may be interested? I also Googled it, I'm not going to lie. But I think for me, I was very fortunate to find the right partner. But I don't know about the other guys.
A good VC firm will take your call. I mean, that's their job, is to take calls and talk to people and listen. So it's not like you're going to have a door slammed. It's not like going to sell a new line to retailers. They're keeping out stuff. But, you know, like VC firms are very welcoming and have oftentimes have programs set up for young designers and people to come in and pitch and certain things like that. So I would say you should look at the companies that you love and the startups you love and the design and then see who they're invested in and then reach out to them.
Or Shark Tank. kidding. Totally kidding.
So are we out of time? I'm looking at the coach over here. So, well, thank you guys, one and all.
Thank you.
You were great. And thank you.